Hey everyone, got a special treat for you this month for Herb of the Month, and that is Boneset. And so this is one of my favorite herbs for pain, and we'll talk about all of its uses. It's amazing. There's almost not a better herb out there. I know I say that every single month because I love the herbs so much, but it's in the daisy family. And it's funny, I had this planted in the back garden, and what happened was other things took over, the comfrey took over, all kinds of stuff. So I moved it to its own spot here, and it's so happy, even though it's a little brown on the bottom, because it really likes moist environments. It likes the sandy soil that we have right here, but it really likes moist environments. So I think it would be a little happier maybe in a moister environment, or maybe having me water it once in a while. As you know, I'm not big on watering the herbs. I try to keep them tough. Anyway, it's in the daisy family. Look at it, isn't it beautiful? And Eupatorium perfoliatum. So this is the name of the scientific name for it. And it's also called feverwort, Indian sage, sweating plant. This came from the Native Americans, and what happened was they probably took pity on the pilgrims that came. It actually was introduced in pilgrim times, and I think it was even brought back to England in 1699 because it was such an amazing herb for bone breaking pain from fevers. It's a feverfuge, so it's got all these old, kind of an old history, really ancient, I'm sure, history with the Native Americans. It was used in the Iroquois, the Creek, the Alabama tribes. And this is kind of interesting from Brigitte Marr's book, The Desktop Guide to Herbal Medicine. The Chippewa hunters called their deer by rubbing the boneset root with milkweed to create a whistling sound. I thought that was really interesting. They called deer that way? What we use this for, Jeff and I and the clinic, is for our anti-inflammatory herbal mix. It's one of the six herbs that we've chosen to put in that formula, mainly because it's so good for low back pain. And you can think of the older animals, how they have a lot of low back pain. But it also has anti-cancer effects that are still not really 100% known. It has, its main claim to fame is it's a great herb for the immune system, building up the white blood cells. It kills bacteria, it helps the body kill bacteria, help the body kill viruses. And so it's an excellent feverfuge. It brings the temperature down. And so it was used in cases of yellow fever and typhoid just the regular flu, to break the fever and to stop the pain. So the reason it's called Boneset is, and that's not to be confused with Bone Knit. Bone Knit is in the back of my garden. That's Comfrey, which is Symphytum. That's Comfrey. This is, Eupatorium. This is Boneset, so they're different, even though this is Boneset and that's Bone Knit. People get confused. I definitely took me like a good year to figure that out. But this herb is excellent for the bone-breaking pain that comes with illness, especially fever-borne illness. But that could also include, maybe chemotherapy or medication-induced pain, where it's right in the bone. And it also has very minimal side effects, even though it's a very strong herb. Brigitte Marr's, in her book, she talks about, and maybe Peter Holmes talked about this too, where they, in pilgrim times and in colonial times, they would have this hanging from their rafters all the time, because you don't want to take it in the fresh form. Really important. It's a strong emetic in the fresh form. You want to harvest it when it's in flower, and you can cut it down. About this time would be a good time to harvest it. And then they turn it upside down and they hang it from their rafters to dry it. So the dried herb in a hot infusion, that is how it was used to treat fevers and flu. And other uses of it, it's a laxative. I'll read off the list. It's kind of a cool little list. So it's an aperient. That means it's mildly laxative, stool softening. and it's an antispasmodic, it's astringent, it's bitter, it's carminative, so it cuts down on gas, it's diaphoretic. So diaphoretic is this really cool herbal term. It really gets to the root of things, and that is you have a fever or heat that's inside or internal in the body, and you want to draw it out to the skin surface. So you want to draw it out and promote sweating, expectoration. And that is what this herb does. It just draws that pain, that inflammation right on out, and, you know, and creates a sweating sort of situation. So let's see, we talked about immune stimulant. It's also a tonic. This spread to Africa, to Europe, when there was no quinine for malaria, in the Civil War and the Confederate soldiers, I think that whole thing, they used this to treat malaria, and I think, other cultures have used it to treat malaria too. So, very, very powerful historical herb, and the Native Americans sharing it with the colonial people, who I'm sure they saw got the flu all the time. Let's see, some of the active ingredients, which I'm going to have a little trouble pronouncing, bear with me. Siscotropin alkaloids, those are what's in it too. They increase appetite. So you can think of an older animal that doesn't want to eat that much, you know, that has a lot of pain in their low back, that maybe has a lot of internal heat from yin deficiency or from panting a lot and pacing and anxiety, and that would be, it's such a great indicator for bone set, although we do think of it more in terms of an antiviral flu remedy. The polysaccharide content, that's what they believe increases the white blood cell count and has the antivirus activity and even the anti-tumor activity. Polysaccharides are like a sugar that's in it. That's why some of those things may not come out that well in tincture form. So this was traditionally used as an infusion, as a hot infusion for antiviral, as a cold infusion for a laxative. And again, just dried and used. It looks like they used from 3 to 9 grams a day. So that's a pretty hefty dose. They probably did it short term, you know, until the person felt better, or animal. In tincture, it looks like it's a fairly, they want you to use a weak tincture, a 1 to 3 at a 35% ethanol, which isn't even as strong. I don't think that's as strong as vodka. So it'd be like a diluted vodka would be your base for it in tincture form. I've never used it in tincture form, but sometimes things last a little longer on the shelf in tincture form. But I think those polysaccharides might not come out as well in tincture form, so it depends on what you're using it for. So in Chinese medicine, dispels wind heat. That's the whole anti-flu thing, dispelling wind heat. And in herbal medicine, in Western herbal medicine, we talk about it as a diaphoretic, so drawing out that heat and evaporating it off through sweat. Cooling the lung, relieving pain, cough, promoting rest, promoting digestion. So I think that's everything on my list. So you can see we use Boneset in powder form in our anti-inflammatory formula. Just looks like a lot of other powders. and sometimes it's hard to powder down because it has all these little hairs on it which grab the blades, so that's a little hard. But love this herb, think it's really a powerful herb, and wouldn't leave it out of the herbal anti-inflammatory formula. I love that it came from the Native Americans, and so this is a very old traditional remedy. I also wanted to share with you, and this is sort of unrelated to Boneset, but I'm trying to experiment more with our local Native American foods. So these are some salal cakes I made, some salal berry cakes. Aren't they pretty? And I thought when we're done here, I'll just have a little snack. It's funny, when you get used to, we don't eat sugar anymore, so when you get used to not eating sugar, eating these berries, it's like they're actually really sweet. They kind of have a sweet sour to them. But anyway, back to the Boneset. So yeah, at this point I would just cut it down. I would dry it by turning it upside down, hanging it in the sun. It dries really easily though, and that I think that's owing to the fact that it has all these little ridges in it. I guess microscopically, the resins, a lot of the resins are in these little yellow circular packages. And I don't see that here. So I'm not sure if I'm blind or if you actually need a microscope to see that. I don't know. Do you see that, Jeff? I don't really see that. It's interesting to see what pollinates it. Like right now, there's kind of a interesting maybe mason bee on there. And then earlier I had a couple of really interesting flies that were on it. So it gets pollinated by a lot of different stuff. And what I'm hoping, of course, is that it'll fill in this whole area behind me. Hopefully it'll just spread for us. So if I were gonna harvest this, I would probably just harvest the big stalks, and I would leave some of these smaller stalks for photosynthesis. And that way, you don't kill the plant by harvesting it. Definitely don't wanna do that. I think this would be a tough one to kill though. Let's see if it has a scent. I don't even know. Oh, it does have a scent. You know, it's funny. I didn't even think about that. You think so much about, what it does and how it's great for pain. And now I realize it actually has a beautiful scent. Very light, kind of a light scent. I guess in some cases it kind of turns a pink purple type color, the flowers do, instead of this beautiful white. Hey, Jeff, can you come in on this bee? There's a beautiful little bee on it. Oh, did he fly away? No, there he is. He's right there. So, I guess that's all I really have to say about Boneset. Very safe herb. There'll probably be some cases where it can cause some vomiting or something like that if it's not harvested correctly. Really needs to be dried. Kind of like cascara in that way. You don't want to just take cascara. Cascara might be more of a purgative, whereas this is much more of an emetic, expectorant kind of qualities. So anyway, if you guys have any questions about Boneset, definitely email them to me through the web membership. And if I don't know the answers, I'll try to find out someone who does. So I guess that's all I have to say about Boneset. I think I'm going to have a salal cake and just give, I guess, thanks to the Native Americans and, of course, what they had to endure for us coming over here and still sharing things like this with us. But anyway, bon appétit!